presented is adequate for these purposes.
Basically, what you're asking for is a revised checkoff list with certain items that...
In effect, yes. Yeah.
Can we take a look at this and see what possibilities are for getting some of these things?
We could. Well, it would be the normal course of action would be that the applicant during the official submission of the site plan review materials would submit everything that he or she felt was needed to be submitted and make a case in writing at that point in terms of what they felt shouldn't be. So I think I'd prefer to have time to look at the materials and discuss it with the applicant before the next meeting so that could be worked out.
Yep, fair enough.
Man, I would caution you on traffic. This subject will come up.
Okay.
Promise.
Okay. In response to that, I think what we would propose to do, if I can anticipate the question, there is an entry and an exit here, as you well know. I think the concern is with respect to traffic exiting from this direction. And we are proposing to either paint the word stop or maybe place a sign in this area to indicate the traffic coming in this direction that they should stop before proceeding any further. If that is the...
You have it under consideration, depending on the type of... You want to put in a restaurant type building. Their parking will not turn over as fast. Therefore, you're going to require more spaces. I don't say this is final statement, but it sounds logical. So this is the type of thing I think you should be ready to discuss.
Do you have any idea what these retail spaces will be used for at this point in time?
No, not at this point in time. Basically, continuation of retail use, though.
Yes. Mr. Chairman, Mr. Patterson, about concerning the bathroom about which you spoke, that will be shared by the two stores, will that be a private bathroom or a public bathroom, since I don't think there is a public bathroom at that whole area?
Well, it would be a bathroom meant to serve the employees and the business invitees of the respective stores. I don't think it's anticipated that it'd be a public bathroom.
Yeah.
The bathroom itself is existing. It's the one that's always been there. Yeah?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
May I speak? Mr. Patterson, on the new bronze aluminum storefront, is this your final plan for these two stores? Will there be a continuity, aesthetically, in the whole shopping area? By doing this, it's hard to imagine it from the picture.
Excuse me,
I'd like to propose, you're thinking of signage change, go along with the center.
Yeah, I think that some design changes with respect to signage is anticipated at the center to make a lot of the signage out there, consistent and aesthetically pleasing.
What I see now there is a bit of a hodgepodge lodge. And I'm just wondering if this is going to add to that.
Yeah. Well, I think that the owner and the applicant has a concern about signage and about making signage more uniform and more aesthetically pleasing. That's an important aspect of the project. Mm-hmm. It always has been, as far as the developer is concerned.
In the last town in which I lived, there were many different kinds of storefronts, and aesthetically, they united those storefronts by painting all of the buildings white. and it really made quite a difference, you know, from an aesthetic point of view. And, you know, there's brick there, I think there's some wood, and now I see bronze aluminum adding to it, so that would be a major concern of mine.
Any other comments from the board? I can go through a few items which basically we were blessed before, because the IGA came before us. And I think there might be some items that we'll be looking for in your submission. One, certainly, as Jack had mentioned, is traffic.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be a continual source of problems for the shopping center as the town continues to grow. And we're certainly going to be interested if there's going to be any changes in circulation, kind of how it's going to work, and how you're going to control that. So I think traffic is one issue. The parking situation, I don't know if that's going to change with this new design or not. It's not.
No.
Okay. Anything you're going to do in the area of landscaping for those storefronts?
Not anticipated, no.
Okay. And the signage is another area that that we are interested in, what you're going to do, what they'll look like, and how that will blend with the rest of the shopping center.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know what it's going to do for the whole parking lot area in terms of internal circulation. Are you going to be changing that in any way, or are you going to change the direction of the car enter or exit?
No, I don't think there was anything anticipated in that regard, although we were intending to make a response to the concern about the entrance that I alluded to earlier.
Okay. I don't have anything else at this point. The next step is to get your materials in so we have a review for the next meeting.
Okay.
And make your preliminary plan.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, there may be some people who are attending tonight's meeting who are not aware of some of the changes that have taken place in the agenda. Would it be appropriate to suggest that there may not be some discussion on those items? People are waiting for them. They might like to know that they're not going to be heard.
Okay, let me go through it again. We've had a significant change to our agenda. And our first item now has been completed, the Palm Cove Shopping Center. The next item is Ken Maxwell for application conference on the site plan review for Farm Market. We have now cut off of the agenda the Eastfield Road zone change. That is not on the agenda tonight. Lisa P. Murray pre-application conference is not on the agenda tonight. And Highlands at Broad Cove pre-application conference is not on the agenda tonight. Those three items have been knocked off the agenda.
Mr. Chairman, if I may, just to explain that all three of those items were taken off the agenda because the applicants themselves asked to be tabled. They asked not to be on the agenda. I just want to make sure that was clear.
Could I just interject quickly? We have something occurred today that I'd just like to read this, if I may. I'd like to read this in regard to the Eastfield thing and then just submit it to the board for your consideration.
Well, we're not considering that on the agenda tonight, so I don't think it really would be in line to do that at this point. It's not something that we're going to be considering at all tonight.
Not at all.
I think it's something that could be submitted prior to the next meeting if it's going to be on the agenda, and it'll be included in our package.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
It's not a vote. It's not going to be an item voted on at all tonight.
Uh-huh. Well, can I hand it to you anyway?
Sure. All right, then the next item on our agenda is Ken Maxwell for application conference for a site plan review, and we're a little early, but not much.
My name is Ken Maxwell. I'm here without an engineer architect or a lawyer. So I don't know whether that means I'm exposed or you're safe. I'm not sure which to do. Basically, this is a pre-conference, a pre-planning conference, the way I understood it, and I'm here basically to just tell you of my desire to build a retail farm market in the town of Cape Elizabeth, and to explore that with you and see whether you have any monstrous oppositions that we might be able to deal with in an informal manner. Now, I did give a two-page item of information for you. If you do not have one, I have some more.
Well, that's the item that was titled Information for March 22nd Meeting of Planning Board, Expert Forum Outside Market, two pages of the sketch.
Yes.
Do all the planning board members have it?
I do have four or five copies here if you'd like it.
Also.
And whether you'd want me to read that for public info, it's up to you.
I don't think that's going to be necessary.
It's up to you whether you want it read for public information, and those of you who haven't seen it can follow along. It's basically just background.
If you can either, as you're in your presentation, you can either paraphrase it or you can read it, whichever way you like, whichever you feel most comfortable with.
Well, I see no reason to read it, per se, as long as I feel as though you can, and I think I feel that way, unless you want to take a minute, and we could do it together. But basically, it just shares that we've been farming in the town for over six generations. For years we were wholesale. 73 we went retail, and at that time we built a market in the city of Portland, there on the north side of the city at Allen's Corner. We've been located there now since 1974, and with a change of certain elements, a population increase, a change in the agricultural community, we feel as though that a market here in the town could be a successful venture, and it would consolidate our operation. It's a long trip across Portland, and I've had many of my neighbors express the frustrations of watching it grow and then watch the tail end of the truck go over the bridge, knowing that they've got to follow it in order to purchase the vegetable. So I've just said in the next to last paragraph, we're excited about this location, which is just south of the medical building. It's on a 10-acre lot, and we own another 80 acres behind it. We have 700 feet of frontage. We like it because it's close to a growing area. We have 600 feet site distance, both north and south. We will have 200 feet between our building and the property line to the south, and there will 400 feet to the medical building on the north side. And it would be located on land that has a lot of ledge, and it does not have that great amount of value even for farmers. It would bother me to take an acre or two of prime cropland out of service to build a building on it. We are proposing a single-story building with a daylight basement in the rear. The building size would be 36 by 60 plus or minus. The building would be located at least 60 feet from the road, leaving ample place of parking. Any drainage problems would be contained on our own property, and we have already installed a storm drain to carry the water off that crosses Spillink Avenue. And this could easily handle any additional water problem that we'd create by parking and blacktopping and those type of things. And we are here today to get your feeling concerning the feasibility of this project. I'm a little bit chagrined to realize that we did have an architect do some site planning with drawing, which is basically what you have. It's just blown up. But I didn't know that folded up in there was a sketch of a proposed building. I only have one of them. But I do have that. Plus, I do have three pictures of our operation in Portland that you could glance at. And I am very proud of something else. I do have a certificate of merit here from the Health Department of the City of Portland for the cleanliness of our operation. We were judged along with cafeterias and other such operations. Even though we do not prepare food, we just have the vegetables there, but the cleanliness of the operation. They judged us with merit concerning that, and I'm proud of that. I'm on the farm, though, so that credit goes to the person who's in the market.
Might be good to pass that around if you'd like to take a look at it.
And I'll talk about this building. It's going to be different. This is a sketch. I didn't feel it would be needed. But it's not going to be a shack. It's going to be something attractive.
I have not called it a roadside market because even from Webster's, I have a disagreement with them. For the pictures that you see of the market in Portland, that's completely different there. It's still on one floor, but there we are backed up against the rear line of our property. So everything has to go in and out the front there. That's why the dock and those things are in the front. Here, we're proposing to do most of that will come in through the rear, although we do have a loading area on the right side where it's sloping. So the plan is, at least of now, to have one loading dock on the rear of the right-hand corner.
So, Steve, is there any zoning problem that we're aware of?
It depends upon how it's interpreted. I guess I'd like to ask Mr. Daigle for the current code enforcement interpretation on that question.
I just asked that so that we won't tie up a lot of time on something that we can't handle.
Thank you. We're just researching that. Caught us talking here. We have not done an awful lot of research, only because, number one, it is a pre-application conference, and it is going to need a full review. But a quick glance, I guess we would say that under a Residence C district, any building or use permitted in the RA zone, if you go to the RA district, there is allowed any agricultural use. That is one definition. A commercial establishment per se, if it was classified as a commercial establishment, would not be in the zone. The other thing would be the famous roadside stand, which I didn't want to mention, but I'm forced to. And I suppose in this case, it would have to be determined as to whether it's an accessory use or not. So it does have some work to be done.
Mr. Chairman, who will determine exactly what this is?
Well, that's a good question. I think what I would propose we do is take a look at the plans that Mr. Maxwell submitted, have staff review them, and give us some recommendations as to whether we have a change of use here or whether it's consistent with the zoning that exists. And we really have to make that determination prior to going ahead with any additional application work, because if it is a change of use or a change of zone, then we're into a different situation here.
I think we've got some guidance on this thing, because historically we've had this type of thing in the Cape in RA zone.
Yeah.
So that it isn't just starting from scratch.
No, I agree.
So I think we can take a look at the plan.
No, of course, like that plan, that wasn't submitted as the final plan, but that will give you our intent, and I don't even know if the rest of my crew is here, the one who had it drawn up, but I think he's pretty, my son that manages is pretty happy that this is what he wants. Now, that doesn't mean the doors can't be changed or this or that, but you can see the intent. Our plan is to have a full-fledged farm market, okay? Now, in Portland, gross sales, we only average 50% from our own farm, okay? Now, if you're going to say you're going to have a retail farm market there, but you're going to sell all your own product or 99% of it or 85% of it, it's out. Now, that doesn't mean I'm loaded with lawn ornaments and that type of stuff. Everything we sell is allied lines of produce. One of the reasons why that's so high is that we buy tomatoes in the spring, you know, May and June, we're open. And you know how high they are then. Now, to have a farm market and not have those before hours come in or between hours, it would be crazy. And so our intent would be operate a farm market. We have been open from the middle of May till the middle till Thanksgiving. That's when we've closed. We have no intentions of being open later than that. Now, that doesn't mean we may not want to be, but they're so exhausted come that time, they want to close the doors and get rested up so they'll be ready for spring, and spring is coming mighty fast, I'm afraid. So that's our intent, and our desire to operate one, an attractive one, and it's going to be an insulated building, it's going to be heated, as far as, and I mean, this is somebody else talking about my money now. It's going to be air-conditioned. Okay, now these are some things that we learned in Portland. I had a desire there to have just an open overhead door farm market, or the Portland wouldn't let me. And I agreed with them when I saw a few rats running around the area and some of those things that, we had to have a closed door market. And that gave us a very healthy, cool environment, which we enjoyed, and we learned from that. So this is my intent. And I just hope we can do something. I'm willing to work with you, but you can't strangle me, or it's a no-go, just if you see the point. Now, I'm not saying that threatening, but the things that we're under, we're going to have some pretty good freedom to run a farm market, not a retail store. I'm not going to go in there and start shrinking the vegetables and putting in the trinkets and slopping out that way. It will go into a retail, it will go into a residential, a residence, by that, if it changes at all, okay, or something like that. Our desire is a retail farm market.
We have to understand, as you submit your materials, we have to understand exactly, how the market is going to be operated. Some of the things you hit on are going to be important in making this consideration. The plan that you just submitted is going to be also important part of our package of consideration. We're also going to be sensitive to all the other issues we talked about a little earlier, get into a site plan, do traffic, how that's going to be handled, parking, how that's going to be handled, the whole thing. But I think the first hurdle that we have to really overcome is use. To do that, I think we're going to need a little more information than we have right now.
I feel that.
For that, you can work with the staff and they can get that information from you.
See, I feel we have the room. And for that, it can be worked out unless you see something that says no. Do you see what I mean? And that's what I'm here for. Now the use, that's out of my hands.
I think use here is something that you should take it on yourself to indicate that this is traditional use. Cape Elizabeth is not a huge town. You can look at the specific farm markets. You can probably name all of them been around in the past 20 or 50 years. I think all of these have purchased from other farmers other than themselves. Some fruit, which you don't
sure.
And my inclination would be to tie this into the past to avoid a lot of unnecessary discussion.
We had a meeting here a month ago, on roadside stands, and it wasn't too well attended, at least on that side of the fence. And it was mentioned then that they didn't seem to feel that many people would be coming into the town and buying property to grow vegetables so they could have a retail market. So it isn't a question of setting a precedent and then having the town flooded with markets. That wouldn't be a concern.
Mr. Chairman, I would just like to say that I'm very impressed. You have come here without an attorney, without an engineer, without a landscape architect, and you seem to have covered it very well yourself.
Thank you.
My compliments.
Thank you. Okay.
I hope that you've gotten a sense of some of the items that we're going to be needing at the next meeting. If not, I suggest that you talk to staff, to Jerry and Steve, and they can give you some guidance. Steve, do you have anything to add at this point?
Not really. I think it is a pre-application conference, and the intent is for the applicant to get your general feelings. Just want to emphasize a couple things for the applicant. One is, in terms of submission dates, that you need to submit material 18 days ahead of time, and also if you haven't looked at it already, I'm sure you have, but make sure your architect looks at the section regarding site plan review just to make sure all those things are covered.
Right.
Other than that, I have nothing else for today.
Our thought would be that perhaps the May meeting would be the soonest we would make an attempt to come back, and of course that would depend on what we found out from you and things like that. Our time schedule, what we would desire would be to build the building sometime this summer and fall, with it being open for next spring.
We have a date for that May meeting. The planning board meeting will be the third Tuesday, I believe. We have a workshop the first Tuesday. So that would be the 17th.
May 17th, so materials would be needed to be submitted no later than Friday, April 29th.
Yeah. Well, we'll be in touch with you and
Thank you, Mr. Maxwell. Our next item, which is a little earlier than we had planned, but if Mr. Taylor is available and going to go ahead with the Dyer Pond Resource Protection issue, we'll move right into that.
Good evening. My name is Bob Taylor. I'm the president of Ibis Corporation, and we have applied to the town of Cape Elizabeth for the subdivision of a portion of 135 acres that we own between Shore and Mitchell Roads, immediately south of our existing Stonegate project. This process began last August, and to date we have obtained approvals from the town of Cape Elizabeth for subdivision on a preliminary basis, and for wetlands alteration. We are here tonight to obtain a permit to approve road construction in a resource protection district. This road construction is described on the plans and submittals that are a part of the subdivision and wetlands alterations applications, and are discussed in an October 1, 1987, two-page document that quickly runs down through the criteria for construction in a resource protection district. This resource protection district is that area zoned RP immediately adjacent to Shore Road that is crossed by the proposed Dyer Pond Road, which services the eight lots which previously received preliminary approval. I think that many of the issues have been discussed as a part of either the subdivision approval or the wetlands alteration approval, and stand ready to answer any further questions that the board may have.
Mr. Chairman, it's discouraging to me that we were not notified ahead of time that Mr. Taylor would be here tonight. It's a total surprise to me, and I have done a great deal of research on this, all of which is at home. I mean, I think that I could probably speak off the top of my head, but I'd like to have all of this research that I have done on this particular road at my fingertips with specifics. And it doesn't seem fair to me that that we were not notified, and I am really distressed.
Well, to come to the support, I think, first of all, of the staff and Mr. Taylor, I think at the end of the last meeting when Mr. Taylor was up in the wetlands office, we had decided that we were going to table the resource protection issue to this meeting. I thought that was fairly clear.
Then why did we receive a notice, a further notice of this?
I think that probably the reason, I'm not going to speak for Steve, is that I think it's timing, 1 week between them, I don't know.
Mm-hmm. I guess I felt that with the notice that was in the statements we made at the last meeting and the information that Mr. Taylor had submitted previously, that the board would have had enough information at hand, that plus given the fact that the Resource Protection District application is very similar to the Wetlands Alteration District application. I felt that those two factors, one, I guess I presupposed notice by all the board members, but I also felt that given that we've gone through most of the work already, that with all that, nothing further was needed. I apologize.
That's all right. I won't be picky about it, but I'll do the best I can when I speak on this and try to remember what I have at home. So.
Right. And what I have done is I have made copies, which I handed out to all of you tonight, of Mr. Taylor's original submissions back in October 1.
Yeah, I see it.
Did you want to proceed ahead?
Oh, sure. Well, as you know, I am vehemently opposed to this particular access road. And as far as I know, our ordinances pertaining to the resource protection zone rule that we should stay away from problems in flood plains. Flood plains are flood-prone areas. This particular access road lies in an area of shore, abuts an area of shore road that has flooded in the past. And according to all of the engineering reports, which I don't have with me here today, despite the mitigating measures that will be taken by the engineers, this would include the weirs, etc., this area, we are assured, is still going to flood. So on the basis of that, and I hope I'm not sounding too general, I would not grant Mr. Taylor the right to place this road in a resource protection area, because we have other areas of shore road that flood, and it's a nuisance. And if shore road floods, your access road is going to flood, and 8 homes are going to be without an emergency access. And since we don't even know what this road is going to be, it's going to be a cul-de-sac, a connector road, you know, that's still up in the air. I feel a lot more comfortable if the access road to your development were not in the flood plain. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Lundy. Any other comments from anyone?
Yeah. Correct me if I'm wrong. We have proceeded with the vote on preliminary plan approval.
Right.
And with wetlands permit.
The wetlands permit was approved last week.
Right.
That is correct.
It appears to me that in granting both those approvals, we have actually considered each point that must be considered for construction of the road in the resource protection district. And it appears to me that the applicant is in a position to ask us to approve this or to insist that we approve it through other means. And it would seem to me the thing to do is to approve it.
We've received an unusual amount of material, a lot of it very technical, on this application, and both from the applicant's engineers and from our own. And I'm satisfied that the 10 items which we have to consider in reviewing the construction in a resource protection district have been answered satisfactorily to my mind. I'm not convinced that the situation will be worse as a result of this road construction. In fact, there's some evidence to suggest that the situation may, in fact, be improved. I hope that that's the case. If it's no worse than it is now, and if none of the other conditions are violated by this construction, I would have no problem in voting to approve the application.
Mr. Chairman, this will be the last time I speak. It's like beating a dead horse or whatever you call it. But according to I think it was the IPE, I keep getting mixed up on that particular firm's name. According to their report, they stated that this was a very bad access road and that it should be totally moved from that area. And I agreed with that report when they stated that the town should address the flooding problem beforehand. And I personally don't feel that Mr. Taylor should have to solve our flooding problems for us with the weirs, etc. It's something that we shouldn't be sweeping under the rug. We've got another flooding problem up at Pond Cove. And there are other places to put this access road, but they have never been really explored. So that will be all I have to say about it.
Mr. Taylor, do you care to respond to any of these concerns that the board has expressed?
It is basically, I think, the issue of location of the access road comes down to a balancing of costs and benefits. I think it was noted in the wetlands alteration approval process that while this road does alter approximately 7,000 square feet more wetlands than the alternate location studied, that the applicant's traffic engineer and the town's traffic consultant, as well as the chief of police in the town of Cape Elizabeth, felt that the currently proposed location, which requires this construction we are requesting a permit for, is the preferable location. In addition, the location and the construction details of this particular road act to reduce downstream flooding, so that we think that not only do we have a positive traffic safety effect, we feel we have a positive effect on flooding, and we feel that the board has, in a prior proceeding, decided that those outweighed the negative aspects of a slightly greater area of altered wetlands.
If we don't have any other discussion,
could I just say just one more thing about it? I think that the current position taken by the planning board on this particular access road going through a resource protection area is inconsistent with what the planning board has done in the past with roads in the resource protection zone. One example, Broad Cove. Inadvertently, a road in the resource protection zone was filled. And after the fact, we were sent there to review it. And the owner of the road was not allowed to repair a culvert that had disintegrated and put the road back together because it was in a resource protection zone and it had been filled. And now we're saying, fine, Mr. Taylor, go ahead, build your road, bisect a pond, put it in a floodplain, it's all right. And I think that's very inconsistent.
If there is no other questions for the applicant, do I have a motion? One has been drafted. Dean, do you like to read it?
Sure. The suggested motion reads as follows. Be it ordered that the planning board makes the following findings regarding the road construction and resource protection district as proposed by the Ibis Corporation for Dyer Pond Road, a proposed 8-lot subdivision located off Shore Road. Findings are that the proposed road construction, A, will not result in unsafe or unhealthful conditions, B, will not result in erosion or sedimentation, C, will not result in water pollution, D, will not result in damage to spawning grounds, fish, aquatic life, bird, or other wildlife habitat, E, will conserve natural beauty, F, will avoid problems associated with floodplain development and use, and G, will not impact shoreland vegetation, visual points of access to water, actual points of physical access, of public access, excuse me, to waters, or the shoreland area land use standards of the zoning ordinance. Be it therefore ordered that the request of Ibis Corporation for a planning board permit for road construction and resource protection district for Dyer Pond Road, the proposed 8-lot subdivision located off Shore Road, be granted according to section 19-2-8 of the zoning ordinance and the facts presented.
I'd like to move that that order be approved as presented.
Second.
Second. Any additional discussion? I'm going to call a vote. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed?
Nay.
The motion passes on a vote of 3-1.
Thank you very much.
I'd like to call at this point in time for about 5-minute recess, and we will pick up our last item on the agenda approximately 8:35 maybe. Thank you. next item on our agenda is review of ordinance tax change by Shane Frank concerning RA zone. This is section 19-22F of our ordinances. And on this issue, member Joel Ross has requested to step aside from voting on this. And we do have four members, so we do have a quorum, and we can proceed. And following procedure on this, I'd like to have Steve bring us up to date. People on this issue has gone through a few changes in direction. We also have Tom Leahy here, our town council. If there are any questions the board has on procedure in this case, suggest we can discuss them with Tom. After Steve's had a chance to get us up to date on history, then I'd like to have the applicant once again state the case and tell us how you changed your approach over the last time you were here.
Okay. Please. Mr. Chairman, in terms of the process, where we are in the general sense is that the applicant asked the town council for a zoning ordinance text change back in the late fall. Town council referred it to the planning board as the town ordinances require. It's now before the planning board now for a recommendation in terms of whether or not the zoning text change should occur. And the planning board, once it makes it, comes to a decision, will then recommend to the town council what it feels that the town council should do. And then town council will take further action, have another public hearing, and then finally it's the town council that makes the final decision. In terms of where we are most recently, at our last planning board meeting, which was last week, just last week, I had revised or amended the zoning ordinance text change that had been submitted originally by the applicant to raise and bring in some issues that the planning board had mentioned at previous meetings. At the end of the last meeting, when we talked about this issue, you asked myself, the town attorney, to meet with the applicant and his attorney to see if we could discuss whether or not the best route to go would be a revised version of the zoning ordinance text change, or to explore the option of perhaps having the applicant apply for a zone change, so that instead of the text change, which deals with allowing boat repair facility in a residential use, the zone change would be changing a certain area around the barn from residence A to some business zone. After some discussion, I think the applicant and his attorney will be able to elaborate further. When we had our meeting, the general feeling was, for a number of reasons, that they preferred the zoning ordinance text change approach. And so for on that basis, and it's laid out in the letter that I gave to you tonight, we went ahead and did that. And what I'd like to do now is just quickly highlight some of the changes with the suggested language that you have before you tonight versus what you saw a week ago. And most of them are highlighted with the footnotes in your memo. In essence, what we've done is we've changed some of the language regarding number of workers that could be working at such a boat repair facility, and we've ended up with a number of four persons, and includes all sorts of workers, part-time, full-time employees, volunteers, what have you. They're all included in that definition of four persons. Another change, well, actually the change is the same as before. I just want to clarify that we're talking about a standard that this sort of facility wouldn't be allowed on anything less than 871,200 feet, which is 20 acres. We had a discussion with the applicant in terms of the number of boats that would be under repair. Again, the applicant, I think, will state his preference, which was really not to have any limitation on the number of boats that could be in some state of repair. I think Tom and I felt that limiting it to two, or in this case to three, boats under repair at any one time would give the town an additional assurance that the commercial activity, so to speak, wouldn't get out of hand and mushroom. So that's
That's why that's in there, and again, I think you'll hear some arguments, both pro and con, for that. The original, the last version that you had in terms of outside storage said that no storage of materials or boats shall be permitted at all. Again, in our meeting, it was pointed out, or it was stated by the applicant, that especially in the summer, or at least for the boats, it's important that those get brought outside for at least certain parts of the summer periods, because it gets very warm in the barns and the boats dry out and do all sorts of other terrible things. So what we suggested as a compromise was that materials not be stored outside, but boats be allowed to be stored outside so long as they weren't visible from a public road, so that you wouldn't have an appearance of a boatyard, a really commercial sort of operation. Two other things that have changed are that there was a standard that dealt with the storage of hazardous materials, and also a standard that required any sort of boat repair facility to comply with all state and local standards applicable to new construction. Generally, it was felt that those two standards that were put in your last draft already would be covered under the existing building permit regulations and site plan review provisions in the zoning ordinance, and therefore those were necessary to be included in this text. So in a rather long nutshell, that's the changes between where we were last week and where we are today. And at this point, it might make sense to have the applicant proceed.
Thank you, Steve. Tom, do you have anything to add to that?
Not at this time. I think the applicant maybe should proceed next.
Okay, could the applicant come forward?
May I inject something here? I think it's better now than later. We talk about no outside storage of material shall be permitted. At some stage of the game, I'd like to see that change to no outside storage of boats or materials shall be permitted. That is visible from any public road. If we prohibit outside storage of materials, we're creating something so vague that nobody could ever interpret it. The code inspector won't know what to do with it. You get OSHA over there, you're talking material supplies, and I think it becomes so complex. And if we just allow the storage of materials along with the boat so it's not visible, I think it would be more workable for everybody.
So your suggestion here is to no outside storage of
boats or materials that is visible. Let it go to that.
Okay. Please identify yourself.
Yes, Chairman Most and members of the board. I'm Peter Murray, and once again, I'm before you on behalf of Phineas Sprague with respect to the operation of his boat shop, boat building area at the Ram Island Farm. The two previous appearances before this board, I believe, we've had the opportunity to briefly describe and in greater length describe what the facility is. What we're seeking is a very limited text change in the RA zone that would permit essentially a small craft type boat construction repair facility as the one that Mr. Sprague has worked his way into on Ram Island Farm. When we originally came before you, we suggested that it be tied to the agricultural activity on the Ram Island in the RA zone for two reasons. One was that we felt that that would be a very limiting factor, that if it had to be carried on with an agricultural activity, that there would be relatively few purely residential areas in Cape Elizabeth where this kind of activity would show up. And the second was that we felt that it was that really was where the legitimacy of the use in Cape Elizabeth came from as part of the tradition of the saltwater farm. At our last hearing, I know the town council and Mr. Butler were of the view, and I guess I would have to agree with them, that the town planning board did not appear to feel that that rationale was very important, that the agricultural tie was very important. And I got the same message as well. So when we conferred last week together at Mr. Leahy's office, we acceded to and agreed with Mr. Butler's proposal that the activity, the boat building and repair activity, be treated as a separate activity all of its own and not be tied into a part of an agricultural activity. So that this change, which Mr. Butler has presented, reflects that change in approach. And if that, obviously that's okay with us, if that's the way the town would like to have it. And that's the feeling we got from the board at our last outing on the subject matter. We did consider the floating zone, and I think I've explained, Mr. Butler's explained one of the primary reasons why we couldn't go very far with it, and that's because of the intricate organization of the Sprague Corporation's land holdings out there have a prohibition on any zoning for business as such. And so anything that is denominated as business is something which is by virtue of the intricate arrangements of the farm not permissible. Although I do point out, and you have in your file, a letter in which the farm president specifically supports this particular change, and they're very much in favor of and in support of the continuation of what has been going on there, as to witness all the people from the farm who came and spoke at the public hearing last week, as well as Mr. Woodsum's letter. We think that the proposal that Mr. Butler and Mr. Leahy drafted with our comments and contributions is a sensible one, and we certainly have no objection to the simplification proposed by Mr. Orr as far as the materials and boats. We think that most of our materials will be inside. We're certainly willing to err on the side of caution in that respect. The point he made is a valid one, and that it's what's in a sense that if they aren't visible from the road, what difference does it make? I think you have a feeling for what is involved in this kind of an operation in terms of materials. You're talking about a little lumber, essentially. And so that would be certainly acceptable to us. The only area on which I think we couldn't reach total agreement on what we thought would be a good compromise, and which was left open for, I guess, us to address with you tonight, is the issue of the number of boats, quote, under repair or construction. It was everybody's intention, and it's certainly our intention, that this operation is going to be of the scale and size of what's going on and what you folks saw out there, that a few craftsmen, and we have exceeded to no more than four at any one time, would be working on the boats. One of the difficult things, though, that we've had is a possibility of difficulty of enforcement or interpretation if you tried to make the other restraint of under repair or construction at one time. There's no question that with four craftsmen could not undertake more than probably one or two major projects like the one that you saw out there. On the other hand, boat building is not always a continuous kind of thing. So that if you do have if there are maybe four or five boats out there, or maybe a couple of little boats being built, or dinghies, you could in a half an hour, with a table saw, get four or five dinghies under construction, and technically we'd be in violation for a very small amount of activity by one person, because boats, there's no change on size of boats, for instance, and it's very possible that under certain technicalistic interpretations, for instance, suppose two or three small boats, dinghies are being cleaned up, are being painted, or maybe being caulked, it's very small like kind of activity that you do in a garage, plus one big project, and suddenly we're over the line. I think that, and also you may have a boat that you work on for a couple of weeks, and then it's not finished, but there's some part that's got to come, or there's something you've got to wait for it to dry or something, so you go work on another one. And does that mean that the first one's still under repair at the time? We think that the real limitation is the number of people. And as long as it's easy to count the number of people who are out there working, and that makes a good sense measure of the degree of activity that is sought to be permitted. But that the idea of the number of boats, quote, under repair or construction is one which is too susceptible to technical violations at the same low level of activity which we're expecting. And so I think that there's no question that four people couldn't possibly handle more than one major project like the one that there is, but it is possible that during the course of time, the four people might be dabbling at this one, doing a little work on that one, maybe painting or fixing up a couple of dinghies, and then somebody might come in and say, well, there's a boat that started to work on and not finished, and there's one that's made in just in frames and plywood, and there's that big one that you've been working on for 2 years now, and then what about those two more that have a drill lying on them? You're obviously doing something on those. And yet it's still the kind of thing we have there. So we are willing to and happy to live with the four persons, which I think is an easy and objective thing to enforce. But we would prefer that the board not recommend the limitation language on the number of boats under repair or construction because of the difficulty and the vagueness of that standard. Other than that, we think that this draft is a very sensible one. It's very limited. With the 20-acre limitation, plus the practicalities of real estate values in Cape Elizabeth, we don't think that there's any possible chance that any other boat shop will develop anywhere in Cape Elizabeth under this exception. There's one point that I believe that Mr. Tinsman, or maybe one of the others of you, mentioned at the last meeting, and that is we want to make sure that by enacting a text change or an ordinance that we aren't suddenly, by negative implication, saying that somebody who sands his lobster boat in his backyard or fixes his pleasure boat in his backyard or takes care of his skiff is somehow doing something wrong. And I think you'll see that this will qualify. This does not address that issue in a way that would negative it, because this is talking about the boat repair facility and boats are repaired, and so this would not address that. I think the town council will advise you that people who work on their own boats would not be required to comply with this particular ordinance.
Thank you, Mr. Murray. Are there any questions from the board? Mrs. Gutman.
Mr. Chairman, I have quite a question here about this letter from Steve Butler to the planning board. And if I may just read a bit of it, there's a puzzlement to me. During our discussion, Peter Murray mentioned that there is a Sprague Corporation agreement that prohibits the use of the Sprague Corporation land for, in quotes, business purposes, and that it would be difficult to change this prohibition. Well, Mr. Murray, you've been saying all along that a farm is a business, and this boat building, whether, you know, we don't think it's bad, but it is a business. And by the same token, the town of Cape Elizabeth has a prohibition in the RA zone on businesses. So something's got to give here. You know, I mean, I think there's a very delicate balance between private property versus government control, and there has got to be a better answer than what has been proposed today. Does that make any sense to you?
I can understand that it's hard. The word business, of course, we don't think it's a business in the sense of any more than a farm is a business. Yet most of you folks say, well, a farm's not a business, but this is. We are not, with our concern about the Sprague Corporation agreements and the Beale plan, is not from the standpoint of this activity, because the Sprague Corporation is on record as far as this activity is concerned. And if, in fact, the Sprague Corporation were to come down on this activity, that's up to the Sprague Corporation, and they aren't. But what they are concerned about is something being referred to or delineated as a, quote, business zone, like Business C,
yes,
or something of that nature. And that's something which we cannot ask for.
Well, that's unfortunate, because I thought that the last time Mr. Tinsman had a very brilliant solution to this, and I thought that the planning board bent over backwards to accommodate Mr. Sprague. And maybe something has got to give over at the Sprague Corporation, because this is a business. And it's too bad that they prohibit it. And we do have a letter stating that they thought it was fine. We think it's fine. But I preferred the solution last week.
Well, the town council may want to address, that's not the only reason why the business C zone did not appear to be an appropriate solution, even though it looked appealing on its face. There are a couple of other much more serious issues from a regulatory standpoint that I can address briefly, and you may want to ask the town council about them. The business C zone, if you look carefully at the ordinance, and we're assuming that the one that says repealed and replaced is the current ordinance, that if you look to see, refers to a zone that's created for these four categories. And then it refers to the fact that, which include light manufacturing, professional offices, a couple of other things. Now then you look at it and it says it's subject to site plan review, period. And if you get a site plan review, they can put that as the business C zone where they want, and you get a site plan review. It does not specifically authorize the planning board to, however, to specify or to limit the uses beyond that description in the business C zone. So there is a risk that you would be creating a spot of, even though you wanted to have something that would accommodate the boat shop, there's a risk that you'd be creating a zone which be permissive of light manufacturing, professional offices, and everything else that's described in that business C, subject only to your right to give a site plan review to it at the time. In other words, the ordinance, I think, seriously question whether you can say with authority that it gives you the right not only to tailor the location of the zone, but also to tailor limited uses less than those covered by the definition of C within that zone. So that you take it from the town council as to what the legal question is, but that is an issue which we all addressed. And then the question is, well, what should we go for an A zone there? Well, an A zone permits all kinds of things, from beauty parlors to barber shops up and down. And again, nobody wanted to permit, least of all Mr. Sprague, to have a speck of land on Ram Island Farm in which you could have any one of a variety of different activities like that. That all we are asking for is the opportunity to carry on this traditional activity which we originally came before you and tried to give you the historical tie with it to farm activities in Cape Elizabeth, and it's certainly a far cry from the smorgasbord of activities that's permitted either in the A or in the C zone. Now, aggressively taken, you could take the aggressive position and you could say, well, we're going to take the C zone and we're going to give that a strong reading and say that we can, by our site plan review power or something, require that the person not cover all the uses. I would be very surprised, and the town attorney will do this, or whether the town attorney could tell you, give you an opinion, that in fact was a ironclad proposition. Because it's not clear from the ordinance that you can limit the uses to less than those required by the C.
Mr. Chairman, perhaps it is time to hear from Corporation Counsel on some issues of legal issues here. At the last meeting, the board felt that it was philosophically in favor of the boat repair facility down at Sprague's land. And we're searching for methods to accomplish that, the methods that could keep the issue moving and keep it alive. We talked about two things. One was the floating zone, and one was the language that had been prepared. And I think I had indicated at that time that either one would be acceptable, philosophically, again, in agreement with the proposal, but that there were some concerns about the language as drafted to ensure that we didn't have a prohibition for the lobstermen and the fishermen in town of repairing their own boats and their own land and having to come under these rules. Whether it's a floating zone or whether it's this language matters little to me. It's how we do it and how we best accomplish the means. I guess I'd like to hear from the town attorney how this does not intrude on existing operations, existing fishermen, existing lobstermen, and recreational boaters. Who want to haul their boat to their own yard and work on it.
So I guess I would ask that question. I'm not sure we necessarily need to belabor the point on the floating zone. The applicant really doesn't want it, and I don't think we should push something on him. So the question is, how do we not intrude on existing things happening in the town? And perhaps even to the other issue on how we ensure that in other RA districts in the community, we're not creating something that could be a concern for other neighborhoods.
Ms. Lane?
I think I've heard about a dozen questions, so I'll try to answer them, and if I miss any of the ones that have been raised, I'm sure somebody will tell me. The last question is, will we have an unintended impact by this change, specifically to those who have recreational boats, who are lobstermen, who may work on a boat occasionally, this sort of activity? I'm not greatly concerned about that for three reasons. First, if it is of a truly of a business nature that has existed for a sufficient period of time, it may be lawfully grandfathered as a pre-existing use to the restrictions in that zone. Secondly, and more importantly, and to your point, the zoning board struggled with whether this past or proposed operation was a boathouse, was an accessory use in a residential agricultural zone. And they just couldn't quite fit it in because they saw it as quite commercial. I think all of the uses that you're referring to would probably be legitimate, incidental, customary uses along with residential and agricultural. So that if I own a residence and I have a boat and I work on it, I really don't think we're going to have a problem in Cape Elizabeth with that. Now, go one step further, what if I want to work on one boat and it's just me and I want to do this on my own residence? There is a third answer, a third solution to the to that question, and that is under the home occupation provisions. Again, this particular case, as it went through the procedures of the zoning board review, was once looked at under home occupation. I will grant to you that there are limitations under home occupation. It must be operated by a resident. There are limitations in that it must be operated in the dwelling unit. And there are limitations on the amount of square footage that may be utilized for the occupation. But to the extent occupation means business, home occupations are allowed in Cape, in the Cape Elizabeth, with some limitations. So I see three areas that are probably adequately cover that concern. An existing business use may be grandfathered. It may be a use that would qualify into home occupation if it's limited sufficiently. Or it may simply be an incidental use that just isn't a problem because it's, I guess the exact term is customarily incidental to residential or agricultural use. So when I look at this proposal, I see that it defines a boat repair facility or it relates to it. That in and of itself is not greatly defined in any detail, but I'm satisfied with that concern about having no negative impact that was not intended. Does anybody have any questions on that particular issue before I leave it?
Mr. Chairman, I do, and I'm glad to hear you say those three issues, and I would sincerely hope that they would be applicable. And we're really not talking about something that happens tomorrow or next year when we're here and we remember what was discussed, but I doubt that these tapes will be available for boards 5, 7, 10 years hence, which the language may outlive members who are on the board or staff to the board. And I don't want to debate any of the issues, and I think your second, the incidental and customary uses, is perhaps the greatest of the three. Mm-hmm. But I just hope that we can protect and resolve those issues today so that we don't have problems.
homes in 10 years. Mm-hmm. So that an overzealous code enforcement officer, not existing staff, of course, but an overzealous code enforcement officer doesn't track down some lobsterman 10 years from now and say that you have a boat repair facility because you hauled your boat out and you're sanding it down or you're rebuilding the cabin or something like that. Those are uses that should be encouraged in the town and not discouraged by having to go through the home occupation where you need some board permission to haul your boat out and do that kind of thing. So as long as we are talking incidental customary uses outside structures, I think we should key in on that and mm-hmm. and just let it be known somehow. I don't know whether or not language in addition to that suggested that, and I guess I'd look to you for advice on that. Is there ever in zoning language that's drafted up that says something like, this doesn't mean that you go after the lobstermen or the fishermen who are working on their own boats in their own yards?
No. I'm afraid that just opens up a whole thing. I mean, I can't stand here and try to fathom the various circumstances that exist out here, some of which may be violations. I don't know. I mean, it's on a case-by-case basis, but the zoning board is charged with interpreting the zoning ordinance. They take that job very seriously, and they spend a lot of time on numerous issues over the years I've been representing the Cape and struggling with what it means and try to apply common sense as well as intent. And I think custom as to what's allowed would also be important. But I don't think there's any way we can kind of give a blessing by saying everything else to do with boats other than the boat repair facility as defined herein is now grandfathered. I don't think we can approach it that way. I guess I see this as one specific thing to address, and I'm reasonably comfortable that under the three criteria that I gave you, most of the things that I've heard discussed are probably okay. They're probably incidental and would be found incidental.
Okay, they are blessed today under our existing ordinance because we don't have a definition of boat repair facility. We're attempting to be more specific in our ordinance, and in being more specific, you include other types of land uses that might have to fall then under that more specific guideline, and that is boat repair facility. I guess I'm satisfied with Town Council, Corporation Council advice that we don't have a problem with existing fishermen and lobstermen. And I think, at least from my standpoint, I think other members of the board, that's a clear intent of the language if it is passed and that it's not somehow interpreted differently. There was another question. That was the RA district.
Mrs. Guthrie's question? Is that, Mr. Stinsman, you're referring to the question Mrs. Guthrie asked?
Probably. It's the question of this particular use being allowed anywhere in an RA district and ameliorating those concerns for other neighborhoods. We could have a boat repair facility in an RA district anywhere in the town.
Yes.
And a lot of question was raised last meeting that I think the term Mr. Moshe used was a camel in the tent or something like that.
Camel's head
in the tent.
When we talk about that, I guess we're talking about precedent, and what precedent does this action, this recommendation by this board have, and the ultimate decision by the council have. I think when we're talking about the camel or the nose or whatever part of the body is in the tent, I think what we're saying is that will you be in any way restricted if an applicant for millworking or some other type facility comes in and says, this is enough like the Finn Sprague request that you really have to allow us or me a new definition, a new specific right to do this in a residential zone. The way I look at it is you just got to take them on a case-by-case basis, number one. I don't think that is precedent or any binding precedent, number two. Number three, I think the Cape has very relatively restrictive ordinances, and I think particularly in the residential zone, they're quite restrictive as to lot size and setbacks and otherwise. And that's good. But I think what you're doing today, if you do make a recommendation, is to say, we think that there is a use that ought to have been allowed along with agriculture. I think that was their main thrust by initially tying it into agriculture, is to say, this is part of saltwater farming. It's certainly a use that was not intended to be excluded. Please put it in. If there is a another use, whether it's tied to farming, that this board and town council would like to see expanded, yeah, you'll take that on a case-by-case basis. If it's something that you don't want prohibited, you can deal with it. I'm not going to be overly concerned about a legal challenge at any time to this action or to the next action, because I think this is quite unique. In response to Mrs. Guthrie's question about why the applicant has asked this not to be considered as either a floating zone or a text change to the BA zone by specifically allowing this or calling it part of millworking or facility, first of all, there is some difficulty with this whole thing of business in a residential zone, but I guess I would say, and certainly not indicating any opinion that you should share, but I think Mr. Sprague's problem with the Sprague Corporation is his problem. I would suggest openly here that by the time this gets to the town council, I would like to see a letter from the Sprague Corporation saying that the text as recommended is acceptable to the owner of the real estate, the Sprague Corporation. They came in with one text. They may leave with another text change. I think that satisfies the concern of the Sprague Corporation, at least the town knowing that the Sprague Corporation, as owner, approves the use. Now, as far as that still being inconsistent, you or any one of you may feel that this, in fact, with four workers at any time is a business and it's in a residential zone, that's a fundamental threshold question. There's no getting around it. What I hear is that you put that on one side of the scale, and the other side you weigh whether you want to have this sort of use allowed in the Cape and whether or not you can have restrictions that limit the effect that you're afraid of. There are limitations here. You can't see outside storage from public ways. You can't. You can only do it on a 20-acre lot. You have certain setbacks, various, and the four people working on a boat. All those things are restrictions that you and your with your planner and some of my assistants come up with as ameliorating type criteria so that you can say this will not, this is acceptable because it's not impacting our residential neighborhoods. And so you can keep the residential neighborhoods free from this, the influence of this ordinance and yet allow this specific facility on this or any other property that is of that sufficient size. There were a couple other questions. I think there was a request by Mr. Sprague, as he has every right to do, to say, well, this is what was finally typed up, but we really would like to have no limitation on the number of boats under repair. By having these footnotes, what we have tried to do for you tonight is really say you make the decision, but we got together and these are the two sides were talked about. You may say you want two employees or six employees. We came up with four. That's acceptable to them, or four people working in a boat. What I'm saying is that's up to you people to finally make that decision. It's not up to me or the town planner. When you talk about number of boats under repair, it's just one more thing that restricts this commercial use, okay, so it's less intense or less has less impact, negative impact on that area. We thought the number of boats would do that. I think it does it to a certain degree. I agree wholeheartedly with Mr. Murray that there are enforcement difficulties in saying that only three boats can be under repair or construction at any one time. There is no proposed limitation on the number of boats in storage. There's no limitation on the size of the structure. This structure is a 100 by 100 foot barn. It's 10,000 square feet. That's greater than the minimum lot size for the lots in the area where I live. So, I mean, we're talking about a relatively large structure with a lot of boats in there, and I don't know how the code enforcement officer is going to tell you that Some are on new construction, some are not. I'm not overly concerned about it. I think it is a limitation. If you people want it, put it in. We'll worry about enforcement later. We'll assume that the code enforcement officer will act in good faith. But I think Mr. Murray makes a legitimate point, and I guess I'll leave that with you. It's, in summary, it's one of those things that adds a limitation to the activity to try to limit it. On one hand, on the other hand, there are some enforcement problems to figure out how many boats are. Every boat in storage may have a little checklist of things to be done before it comes out of storage. You know, I'm not sure who's going to be able to tell what's under repair at any time. As happens periodically when I get up at a meeting and we have some language in front of you, I found one where I think maybe a area that should be corrected. There is proposed to you a setback limitation of 300 feet front, side, and rear setbacks. As I thought about that, I believe the town enforcement division has interpreted setback to be from the public or private way. Certainly streets are defined as public or private ways. I've only been in this area once or twice, meaning this specific site where the Mr. Sprague's property is located, but the if that road that runs by the barn is a private way serving two or more residences, then this setback requirement could present problems to begin with. I haven't had time to confer with them. I would suggest an immediate solution is to say, as you did with visibility of outside storage, which is to say setback from a public road. So I offer for your consideration where it says 300 feet front, side, or rear setbacks. Instead of leaving it just like that, say setbacks from a public road. And that makes clear that if it is a private way of any sort, it need not be set back that amount. If you feel it should, I suppose it could be covered by site plan review. You feel that it should, as a matter of law, always be set back this amount, even for private ways, that's a problem we ought to address. But I'm, unless Mr. Murray or code enforcement officer wants to correct me, I just see that as a potential problem right off on this project here, that that's a substantial setback and may not qualify right off the bat.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Is it all right if I ask you?
Absolutely.
Why the 20-acre limit? This farm, as I recall, has over 2,000 acres. What made you put the 20-acre limit on this?
As I understand it, the Sprague Corporation holdings exceed 2,000 acres.
Yeah.
However, the property has been legally subdivided, not sold, but subdivided for family division purposes. I don't think it relates to the amount of land they have. I think it tries to make this not so specific to that piece of property, allows boat repair to be a use elsewhere in the Cape besides on the Sprague farm,
mm-hmm.
but obviously limits it substantially. And the whole point is to limit its impact upon a given area. It's probably going to be agricultural area right now. It's probably economically going to have the effect of limiting the use of property. No one with 20 acres is likely to use that property for boat repair in Cape Elizabeth other than on this property. I dare say, it's my own opinion, but it's going to be with the highest and best use of most property. It will not be for a boat repair facility.
Mm.
It's out of the sky. I mean, it's just it's arbitrary. It could be 15, it could be any acreage.
Thank you.
I would point out that there are two things that aren't addressed in here, and I assume some time ago they were considered or discussed, or maybe not, and that is that there is no provision that the applicant provide off-street parking that can be covered on your site plan approval. So that's why I assume it's not there. But there is a limitation on off-street parking and home occupations. I assume with this size tract of land, no outside storage visible, we assume we have a large enough tract of land with four employees. It's not a big issue as to off-street parking. There's no provision limiting signs. And again, I only throw that out because on some uses there are limitations. And again, I assume because of the other limitations, that one wasn't necessary or will be addressed in your site plan approval. I guess generally I just want to say I'm in favor of this approach, meaning that under some of our cases from our law court, you are now constrained in your ordinances to be very specific with the criteria upon which you will judge whether a use is allowed. The old provisions of conditional or permitted uses saying so long as it doesn't negatively impact the neighborhood and so forth are just too vague. What I see you doing here, and I know the town is working in other areas, congregate housing and other areas, what I see you doing is trying to be very specific as to specific uses. I think the ordinance has a better chance of withstanding an attack for vagueness or for lack of specific standards if you do that. So I'm not opposed to your being very specific in the criteria here. I think it's a good step forward in that respect. Obviously, the decision is ultimately yours. Yes?
Tom, is, you know, all of the neighbors were here. Everyone is very much in favor of this craft. I certainly am. But is there another way that you haven't mentioned to achieve the accommodation of Mr. Sprague's boat shop? We discussed this.
No, we've considered accessory use, and I just don't think this sort of use could ever be called accessory because it's the law requires it to be incidental to. We have, although we've thrown in boathouses, this zoning board has ruled, and I'm afraid a court would rule also, that you just can't expand that to a primary use and get away with it. It just doesn't fit that way. Business use, I agree with Mr. Murray. If you go with, in the sense that if you go to a BA zone, it has negative impact for the Sprague Corporation and for a lot of people who came before you because it allows all sorts of different uses. And that is kind of a shotgun approach, which is unacceptable to a number of parties, I suspect. It may be more pure to you to call it a business and call it a business zone, but it has a lot of other impacts for other people. And lastly, the floating zone, again, that's not a bad concept. If you reject this approach, then I suspect they'll have to reconsider the alternatives. I think it would fit there, but I think that there are, if it did fit there, we may have to do two things. We may have to, one, change the zoning ordinance text to allow boat repair. So that's in there with the light manufacturing, et cetera.
Mm-hmm.
And then say any use which has been approved, for which a site plan has been approved under this provision, shall be limited, or any property should be limited to that use and cannot be used for any other provision. So we'd have to say what Peter suggested as a problem, that I couldn't give you a definitive opinion that if they had a site plan approval for boat repair, they couldn't go to light manufacturing later. They would have to get site plan approval, but the applicant before you can say, look, you're limited in site plan approval. You can only deny me light manufacturing approval if you can hang your hat on 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And you may not like that light manufacturing, but if it meets all those criteria, I think you're stuck without a zone change. So I think the zone change is twofold. First, allowing boat repair in, and secondly, saying that nothing that first starts under a floating zone and that use can be changed to another allowed use. So, and once that would get in the process of your review and town council review, I'm sure there are probably some other questions that will come up with the floating zone. So for those reasons, they've made a decision not to request that. We've taken taken them on the word on that and said, this is what's requested of you. If you don't, if you don't recommend it, they might go back to the drawing boards.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I guess I'm convinced that this is the most appropriate means of doing what is being requested. And I think that with the standards that Steve has drafted, that we're preventing an obtrusive use from occurring in an RA district and other parts of the town. If we can then move ahead a little bit by asking Mr. Murray to come back up and talk about, at least for my questions, some of the specifics. Tom indicated that a 300-foot setback may be inappropriate for this particular case, and if you could respond to that.
I thank Tom for thinking of that point that he made of suggesting that be added from the public road. I'm not sure where that road goes. Finney just said the road that goes to the barn goes to the beach, and whether that would mean that that qualified as a private way, in which case it would under this language need to be 300 feet setback from the barn road itself or something. I think that his proposal seems to be seems to make sense to say that the 300 foot setback would be measured from the public road.
Would that be for front, rear, and side all?
That would all qualify from 300 feet from front, rear, and side from public road.
What happens when you have a setback, a rear setback, that we'd be looking at from a property line, I would presume, and not from a road, which typically is where your rear and side setbacks are? I understand.
Well, yeah, I think the point you made though was a good one. So perhaps we ought to say from all property lines and from public roads.
Let's also keep in mind that this isn't a zoning amendment that's only for one property, although one property is bringing it up, that there are other properties that this could pertain to that wouldn't necessarily have 2,200 acres.
Sure. No, I agree. And that's why I would say that if the intent of the board is to say that this should be isolated by 300 feet from any neighbor and from the public road, that then maybe that's what we ought to provide.
At or abutting properties. Call it public road or abutting properties, I think. I wish we'd caught this earlier. We could have thought about that. That's a good point.
The other issue and the question that you raised earlier was the three votes. Assuming some standard would be required from the board, what would be the best, in your view, quantification of a standard for number of boats? Would you be looking at size? Will you raise the prams or the dinghies not coming under the count? Or would you talk about the number of boats?
Well, we talked about that for a bit, and I think that the best standard is the one that's embodied in the ordinance as it is, which is the number of persons. Because all persons are pretty much the same size, and they're there. They're either there or they're not there. They aren't maybe underprepared today or tomorrow, so they can be counted when they're there. And no work can go on unless the people are there to do it. So that that definition seems to hit all of the things. Because a boat, when it's not being worked on, is just there. Nothing's being done about it. Some people have dozens of boats on their property. Certainly, as I said to Mr. Leahy, I had seven boats on my property last year, including canoes and inflatable boats and my big schooner and my little dinghy and the sailboat and the sailboard and so forth. And so,
so you have 2,200 acres?
No, I don't. I have a city lot in the city of Portland that's much smaller than this. So I think that we try to struggle with that as to whether we'd have a certain size or shape or whether they be wooden or plastic. And I really think that the thing which touches the legitimate concerns of everybody as far as activity is the number of people working. The thing that I think touches the question of appearance is the setbacks and the visibility. And that the number of boats there, whether it be, because you can imagine if they had 10 boats there and nobody was doing anything on them, it wouldn't matter a bit. But if they had two boats there and there were an army of people coming and going, working like bees, that would be quite an active place. And so that's why I would recommend that the number of boats under repair, that sentence just be struck, and that the board, that we be satisfied with limiting the number of activity that goes on there, and also screening and making sure that it would not have any negative impact from the standpoint of distance to the roads or visibility of any boats or materials. and so forth. That's what I'd suggest, Mr. Tinsman, as far as taking care of that problem.
I have one question for staff. Maybe I'm reading this wrong, but we have on your memo, Steve, we have a footnote down under 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. Oh, thank you, Mr. Murray. I'm sorry. Footnote 5. And when I read 5, it doesn't seem to be any correlation. Was there a question on the time? Or what was the footnote?
The footnote is after the colon, semicolon, meaning that what used to take the place of that small space, and there used to be two standards that were there that aren't there anymore. One dealing with hazardous materials storage, another one with, you know, the applicability standard. So this one, to let it be shown that, you know, if you compared last week's version to this week's, okay, that there would be the gap there.
So the time. So we would be setting a standard of 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. 7 days a week. Is that correct?
That's how it would be interpreted now, and the applicant said that they would have no problem with that. Yes, it would be 7 days a week, though.
Okay. Are there any other questions from the board?
I get a little bit uncomfortable with the three boats limitation. Not because I want you to have more boats down there, but that is pretty tough for any code enforcement officer to call, because you're going to take in a boat, you're going to move it out, then you're going to take a second one, then you move that one out, then you bring the first boat back in, and the code enforcement officer has to come down and decide which boats are under construction. From an enforcement standpoint, bothers me a little bit. On the other hand, we don't want to see an automated canoe factory down there in 20 years. I realize that. Can we limit the number of boats upon which operations are currently being performed, or some such approach as that?
Mr. Chairman, I guess I was convinced by the arguments of the numbers in the last presentation by Mr. Murray that if you have four people working, you may have five, six, seven boats there, but at any one time you're going to be limited in number of boats, certainly to four. Yeah. At any one moment, if all people were working on different boats at the same time. I think that the assumption is correct that with appropriate screening and with the appropriate limitations that this shows, and as long as we're not affecting other operations that are already in town, that it may be appropriate even without the boat standard. And I'd be prepared to make that motion if it were acceptable.
That we eliminate the
number of boats.
Yeah.
Well, there is no motion on the floor at this point.
That's correct.
We are free, I believe, to amend the motion that's been proposed to by staff and put anything we want, really. So,
well, if it's appropriate, I'll make a motion, then we can do it with it as we wish.
Are we ready? Mr. Pinker,
be it ordered that the Planning Board recommends the following amendments to the zoning ordinance for adoption by the Town Council. Amend Section 19.2.2 of the Cape Elizabeth Zoning Ordinance by adding P, boat repair facility in which boats are built or repaired, provided that no more than four persons shall be engaged in a continuous basis in boat construction or repair, that no facility shall be maintained for commercial purposes on any lot containing less than 871,200 square feet, that 300 feet front, side, and rear setbacks from a public road or abutting property be provided on the lot with the facility, that the visibility of the facility be minimized from abutting properties and from public roads, and the facility not have a commercial appearance, that no outside storage of material, and Jack, you're going to have to help me with this one, see if this is right, that no outside storage of material...
No outside storage of boats or materials. That is visible.
That no outside storage of boats or materials that is visible from any public road shall be permitted, that the hours of operation shall be limited to be between the hours of 8 a.m. and 6 p.m., and that site plan review and approval by the Planning Board shall be required.
Okay. Is there a second to this motion?
Second.
The motion has been made and seconded. Any discussion? Hearing none, I would like to call for a vote. All those in favor of the motion as presented, please signify by saying aye.
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 All those opposed? The motion passes unanimously, 4 votes. Please.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Is there any other business to come before the board?
Seconded. Nice job.
Good job.
Very good.
Very, very. How are your swans on?